After utterly dominating the market with the Nintendo Entertainment System, Nintendo moved ahead in 1990 with their next system, the Super Nintendo Entertainment System. Nintendo seemed next to no competition with the NES and their multitude of mascots, most notably Mario. Heading forward with the SNES, the expectation was for it to remain that way, until a company named Sega saw an opening. One might say, a genesis for the company. They crafted a new mascot, and in 1991, the world went Sonic the Hedgehog, and the intentions behind his creation were readily apparent. He had a simple job, to rival Mario and dethrone him. Sega launched perhaps the most aggressive marketing campaign in video game history, and what followed was the most legendary battle gaming had ever known. Video games were still in their infancy as a medium. They were still so new and poorly understood by those on the outside. Fresh new ideas, shiny new characters, it was inevitable someone would attempt to cash in on the brand new trend. Nintendo had tried to expand to other mediums, with shows such as the Super Mario Bros. Super Show, The Legend of Zelda, and Captain N the Game Master, and had even attempted to move into film with productions like The Wizard, but more infamously, the 1993 Super Mario Bros. Film, which, while now considered a cult classic, received such a backlash, it caused Nintendo to become overprotective of their IPs. Even today, all notable Nintendo adaptations are partly owned by other companies. Sega didn't have the same reservations, and pushed Sonic into whatever format would take him. What followed was a slew of adaptations that seldom matched the tone or universe of Sonic. Shows such as The American Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog, a Japanese OVA, Sonic Underground, a British comic book, and an obscure manga. Most important to our story is Deke Productions' Sonic the Hedgehog cartoon, more lovingly referred to as Sad AM. Sad AM is probably the best known of those adaptations, however, not for what it did, but for what it spawned. A spin-off publication of sorts done by Archie Comics, best known for their titular character. Archie acquired the brand and started to publish a monthly comic, primarily based off the Sad AM series, though technically its own independent thing. Much to most people's surprise, during its run, Archie Sonic the Hedgehog became the longest-running comic book based on a pre-existing property. It ran for almost 300 issues, and for the longest time it seemed unstoppable, until 2017, when it all came crashing down, and its destruction being because of one man. The comic was brought down in the end by one of its most influential creators, who is, without a doubt, the most hated man in the Sonic the Hedgehog fanbase. Discussion of him being almost universally negative. That man being Ken Penders. When Ken Penders first encountered Sonic the Hedgehog, he had already been experienced in the comic industry, having worked for big companies like DC and Marvel. When he entered in the fray with Archie Sonic the Hedgehog, his writing was nothing like it would become. Archie Sonic was a comedy book filled with fourth wall breaks and surreal humor, not much different from what Archie was doing with their other titles. Ken had little to work with aside from the Sad AM cartoon, which, when he started, was close to ending its run.
And as we found out, Sega really didn't have any idea what they wanted in terms of stories. They were dependent on writers to submit ideas, which they would decide, okay, yeah, well, we like that one, we'll go with that, or no, we don't like that, you know, digit.
Ken and his fellow writers would compensate by taking ideas from popular Silver Age comics and parodying them.
Initially, we were just riffing off of old comic books, cartoons, whatever, because we just didn't see any direction from that was usable from any other source material. Sega wasn't providing it to us. We kept asking for reference material from the Deke animated series. I wouldn't even get that until like issue 35, 36 when I was working on that. So it was out of necessity
Riffing on other comics is very present in the very first issue Ken wrote for, where Sonic takes a wrong turn in a special zone and ends up on Anti-Mobius, a dark reflection of the prime reality, where the mad scientist Ivo Robotnik is no longer a dictator who enslaves animals to do his bidding and torments Sonic. Robotnik is now a kindly animal doctor who is terrorized by the evil, villainous anti-Sonic. To those who are familiar with comics, this is obviously a copy of Earth 3 from DC Comics, even sharing some of the same character ideas. The focus of the comic will remain slapstick and comedy for a time, but slowly the comics became more plot-driven, fleshing out the characters and expanding on the lore, of which there was not any. However, eventually Sonic's soaring popularity in the 90s would come to his end. His cartoons ended, and the classic era of games was closing with the Genesis on its way out, leaving only the comics. The way the franchise was changing at the time would even lead Ken to say that the lead writer for the Sat AM series, Ben Hurst, said that the torch was passed to him. Just for the record, Ken Penders of Archie Comics has often said that Ben Hurst says the torch has been passed to me for Sonic the Hedgehog, usually expressed in a way to make it appear that I passed the torch to him. Not true. I was just trying to be nice. What I said was that since the comic was ongoing and the animated series was over, the torch had been passed by default to him. I was just trying to prevent a flurry of inquiries from fans pinning his opinion against mine on how the Sonic universe should be sculpted after Sat AM ended. The way he has expressed it in the past seems to convey the impression that he has my approval on his work. He doesn't. I've not read a single comic. Best of all, Ben Hurst. As far as anyone on the comic knew, the days of the comic were numbered. So Ken, alongside his fellow writers, decided to go out with a bang, ending with the endgame plotline, billed as the epic finale between Robotnik and Sonic. We must start talking about the most notable moment of the comic, which, surprisingly, isn't even the climactic battle between hero and villain. But instead, it's the beginning, where Sally Acorn is chopped up and stuffed inside Kyle Rayner's refrigerator. Okay, it's the scene where Sally brutally falls to her death. Penders has been vocal about his hatred of Sally Acorn as a character, because in his mind he threw off Sonic's too cool for school attitude and slowed him down. So of course the logical step was to kill her off. Penders got away with this for a while until Archie Editorial stepped in and told him to revive her for promotional purposes. For a little history, at the time Sally in the eyes of many Western Sonic fans was the main female character of the Sonic the Hedgehog franchise. Amy did exist as a side character in CD named Rosie the Rascal, but she was only relevant in Japan and Europe, where she had a head start with the manga and the Sonic the comic. Sally's popularity was very regional. Sally was more popular in the United States and Australia. In Australia, where Sally was a full-blown mascot in Sega World Sydney, where she even participated in musical numbers. Sally was definitely present in America at the time. Sally was the star of the comics and the cartoons. The Sonic CD manual even mistook Rosie the Rascal for Sally Acorn. While now Sally is a pretty B-tier Sonic character, back in the 90s she was a big deal. And this was the character Penders wanted dead. Sally's preordained demise did not stop Penders from introducing another very controversial plot element. Sally, who was roughly 15 years old, was heavily involved in a love triangle with the fellow 15-year-old Sonic, and the 20-year-old Jeffrey St. John, a creation of Penders himself. Ken would later publish a rather infamous tweet, where he says Jeffrey, a 20-year-old, was the one to take Sally Acorn, a 15-year-old's, virginity, because Sonic is fast, but Jeffrey is faster. Eventually, through all the angst and melodramatic text bubbles, Sonic beats Robotnik, and a portal opens which flings Sonic a few hours in the future and kills Eggman. We're good. There's a cute wrap of what happened to all the characters after the story, and that was supposed to be the end. But Archie had no reasons to stop one of the most popular series. Archie chose to extend the series past issue 50, leaving the writers to have to come up with ways of continuing a story that was over. This was a perfect opportunity for Penders, who had wanted to replace Robotnik as the main villain for a while, with his new characters, the Dark Legion. Archie themselves did not care what happened to the book, leaving the writers with little to no oversight. Essentially, Ken was given what he always wanted, free rein to do whatever he pleased, or so it seemed. Archie might not have stepped in, but other writers did, writers such as Carl Bolders, who often interrupted the creative vision that Ken had for the series. Comics as a medium are collaborative, and it is very rare for a comic to be one person's visions. For example, Watchmen was a collaborative effort between Alan Moore and Dave Gibbons. Both contributed to the story, and both had a say in how the art turned out, yet it is common for people to give Alan Moore all the credit for the comic. So when discussing the Archie Sonic comic, it is hard to tell what is and what is not Kent, as Kent had a hand in every single aspect of the comic. He did hold every single position one could hold for a comic on the Archie series. For example, Sally having her bones crushed on the sidewalk was Ken Pender's idea. Sally slapping Sonic was Kara Baller's. But luckily, there is one series that streamlines all of this. A series that is as clear a window into a man's mind as a person can get. That series is Archie Comics, Knuckles the Kid.
The storyline, it's actually, the stuff I take most pride in is definitely the Knuckles material. And Knuckles, it was a very organic experience. It was a building block. You know, all that was in existence at the time when I started the very first Knuckles story is he was an echidna, he was guarding a Chaos Emerald on the floating island, and that was the extent of it. So, and that is reflected in the very first story that I did. And then, and here's the story about that first appearance. Once we did that first story, Sega didn't want us to publish it. They actually sent editor Scott Fulop a memo saying, don't do this. But at that point, the book was already on the presses, so Scott had to tell the people at Sega, okay, we can pull the book, but you're going to pay for all the costs involved, you know, for the delay, for redoing the issue, for going back to press, and so on. And once Sega heard those numbers, they said, nope, fine, do what you're doing, and, you know.
It's weird now, but in the 90s, Knuckles was very popular. Back then, Knuckles was to the Sonic series what Shadow is now. So when Archie wanted to make a spinoff, they offered Ken a deal. Stay on Sonic as the lead, or have your own series where you can do whatever you want. Guess which one he chose. I'd like to state now that most of my research for this next part is from a Medium article by Bobby Schroeder. I'm going to reference it a lot, and I think you should all go check it out. This isn't sponsored, by the way. Ken viewed Knuckles as his Conan. This would be a legendary epic tale detailing the life of a hero beginning to end. The thing is, Ken's writing is weird. While Sonic was a hodgepodge of ideas from many different writers, sibling series Knuckles the Echidna, following Sonic's longtime rival turned friend, was entirely the brainchild of Penders, and he had so little creative oversight that he got to write whatever he wanted. The result was a heavily serialized story that slowly unraveled the mystery surrounding Knuckles' origins, his enormous family tree, his ever-expanding array of superpowers, and his heroic destiny. The Knuckles stories were just as weird as the mainline Sonic series. Several arcs would attempt to tackle the subject of fascism, which infamously led Penders to rewarding
Martin Niemöller.
First They Came, to be about Dr. Robotnik persecuting hedgehogs and echidnas. There was also the issue where friend of Knuckles' ally Charmy Bee dies from eating a chili dog laced with lemon sun-dropped dandelion. Remember, these comics were ostensibly aimed at preteen kids. End quote. There was more weirdness than insect children overdosing on LSD. There was also South American Cannibal Cats, the Sally Dip story, and Knuckles' origin story, which, going off of Bobby Schroeder, before he wrote Knuckles, Knuckles' origin was simple. He was the last of his kind, guardian of the powerful Master Emerald. He was kind of dumb, but brave and loyal. At the end of Penders' run, he was a genetically altered messiah from a race of advanced colonials. Penders was known for creating new characters, especially those that were echidnas. His most contentious creation was that of Knuckles' father, Locke. Locke is centered to a lot of controversy within the Sonic fanbase, but I feel that this is best summarized by his TV Tropes profile, which lists his first trope as being an abusive parent. Quote, he blasted Knuckles' egg with the chaos energy to turn him into a living chaos emerald, abandoned his son at the age of 10, and spied on him until their eventual reunion. After the events of Return to Angel Island arc, he effectively disowns Knuckles and tries to blackmail him by threatening his mother's safety. End quote. Even though Penders did not see Locke this way, this is how the fanbase interpreted it. The list of wrongs doing by Locke is long. The TV Tropes doesn't even mention that fact that Locke tricked his son into thinking the entire echidna civilization was dead. Sadly for Ken, the dream could not last forever. After 32 issues of non-stop weirdness, the comic ended, only for him to pick up right after it ends with the same stories just in the mainline comic. The vast pantheon of echidnas Penders created would have a drastic effect on the rest of the comic's run. Now is a good time to mention that Penders was very protective of all of his characters. He didn't like other writers touching his characters. For the most part, Ken did not like anything other writers did. For a matter of fact, he didn't even pay attention to what Sonic as a franchise was doing. He did not play the games. The only time he did was when he was forced to. With adaptations of Sonic Adventure 1 and Sonic Adventure 2, adapting existing content did not stop him from adding his own ideas, such as the aforementioned South American cannibal cats. Ken Penders' contribution is not limited to just echidnas. Penders was brought in at a time where Sonic did, admittedly, have a limited pool of characters to draw from, but there's still more than enough to fill a comic with. Ken was not satisfied with what he had, however, and thus Ken Penders went on to introduce 200 plus characters to Sonic's cast. Archie was supposed to tell Sega whenever they create a new character so that Sega could hold the copyright, though as we'll get back to later, that never happened. This is where we draw into question Ken's creativity, as the characters Ken created were usually along the lines of SBO with a hat, ever so slightly not Vector, Female Charmy, Old Antoine, Sonic with hair, who would later become RoboSonic, not to be confused with the other RoboSonics, Female Espio, Sonic with a jacket, and Archimedes the Ant. And do not worry, Knuckles was not left out either. Knuckles on Star Wars cosplay, Knuckles with sci-fi eyebrow decor, Knuckles with an Instagram filter, Darth Knuckles, He-Man Knuckles, Knuckles in overalls, Dr. Knuckles, Palpa Knuckles, Metal Gear Knuckles, Knuckles but Zod, Superhero Knuckles, who's actually a bad guy, Crunch Knuckles, actually Knuckles with dots, Ghost Knuckles, Old Knuckles, a Knuckles who's been to a Native American museum once and thinks he gets the culture, Knuckles in a vest, Knuckles with a goatee. We also have Female Knuckles, Pink Female Knuckles, Female Knuckles with a headset, Purple Female Knuckles in a dress, Passably Distinct Female Knuckles, just a Robin Hood character, Lara Sue with a Disney princess name, Red Julie Sue, Purple Julie Sue, Julie Sue again, Julie Sue again, and Julie Sue again. This is not to imply Ken Penders had no original ideas. He had plenty of unique characters that were humans and plenty of new species, but the overwhelming majority of Ken Penders' characters are slight reskins of pre-existing Sega creations. It's like taking a pre-made pony base and putting your own spin on it, which I don't think is an insult to one's creativity, but it should not be treated as an entirely original idea or anything short of derivative. But back in comic book land, being a collaborative medium, of course it was only a matter of time before someone else decided to make major changes to Ken's work that Ken just could not ignore. That would come in the form of the Return to Angel Island arc, written by fellow Archie writer Carl Bowlers. This can be considered the last straw for Penders, as it took the Kina civilization that he'd built up and burnt it to the ground. Ken, who prided himself on not reading others' works, was distraught to find out that others' works had finally caught up to him. There were a few other incidents, such as Archie wanting to change the direction of the Mobius 25 years later storyline, which Ken considered to be his magnum opus. It was around issue 159 that Ken decided to leave. His final contributions would come 10 issues later with issue number 169. Ken left Archie for other pursuits, with only two simple guidelines to follow: not to kill Julie Sue, and not to kill Locke. It would take fan-favorite writer Ian Flynn all of 15 issues to kill Locke. Ken had set his sights bigger than the comic book world. Ken wanted to go to Hollywood. Ken's adventures in Hollywood lasted about 5 years. He worked in the art department for King of the Hill and a show called Alien Racers, both around 2005. Ken even directed some of his own projects. He started around 2003 with his own company called Floating Island Productions, which is unsubtly named after Angel Island, a recurring location in the Sonic series, which is home to Knuckles. One such project was The Republic, a series that he's described as predicting Trumpism before Trumpism. The earliest mention of this project I could find dates back to 2010. It centers around the Alden family. While the plot is still iffy, it mostly centers around their troubles during a massive social upheaval. Ken created a website with it that was abandoned around 2013 and replaced with this. For such a small project with a rather low budget, The Republic has several notable actors and impressive talent like composer Andrew Spence. The Republic has been in development for a decade, without any sort of release besides some photos and clips here on YouTube.
No word on casualties.
Oh man, I'm late. I gotta go. Man, I'm late. I gotta go.
Fire.
Dad. Oh, hey, Betty, wait, careful, I got coffee. Bye-bye.
Bye, Dad.
Bye.
Ken is still working on it to this day, as he finds his message about political extremism relevant to today's culture, though when or if it will be released is unknown. Not all of his projects are so lucky. Back in 1998, Archie decided to cross over their Sonic imprint with various properties from Image Comics, a company founded by a multitude of ex-Marvel employees, notably Todd McFarlane, Jim Lee, and Rob Liefeld, which is well known for its creator-owned imprints. Penders, who has always felt passionate about creators' rights, managed to secure his own creator-owned comic book at Image, named The Lost Ones, which he decided to make the center point of the Sonic Super Special No. 7, as clearly seen on the cover. Despite the comic featuring characters such as Spawn and Savage Dragon, Penders decided to focus the plot around his creation Particle and Dr. Ian Droid. The issue was poorly received, and has never been reprinted as it is a legal nightmare. 2 years after Sonic Super Special No. 7 came out, Image launched The Lost Ones. The Lost Ones is an all-ages series about the descendants of the victims of the nuclear bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Harry Kurosawa, aka Particle, is part of those descendants, being studied for their powers, caused from the radiation. The study was abandoned, and the subjects were lost. From the mind of Ken Penders, author, artist, producer, and director, comes The Lost Ones. With a single question: can they and normal humans live together in harmony, or will one destroy the other? And who else might be a lost one? The Lost Ones lasted all of one issue. Penders claims the comic was a bestseller and a cult classic, and was only cancelled due to corporate shakeups. However, given the comic's near total obscurity and no such shakeups occurring at Image around the time, and Penders' well-established habit of inflating his own sales numbers, this is unlikely. The comic's failure did not cause him to drop the Lost Ones brand. Instead, he turned it into an action film, starting production concurrently with The Republic. It got a trailer in 2015, which I'll let speak for itself.
Not quite what you expected.
And that is it. The last update I could find on it was on his Facebook in 2016, saying that they need additional funding, which, seeing as it has been 4 years and dead silence, they likely did not receive. Penders seldom mentions the project. He talks about it as if he would need to start over if he were ever to pick it up again, leaving this project's current status as dead. But like all of his work beforehand, even in the larger entertainment industry, Ken could never get away from Sonic. But for a second, let's rewind back to 2003 and divert our eyes back to SatAM legend Ben Hurst. After SatAM's cancellation, leaving the series tragically on a cliffhanger, Ben had been trying to get a revival of some sort going for The Lost Season 3. However, in all attempts, he had failed. Ben did work on the series Sonic Underground for a little bit, but he had his heart set on Season 3 of Sat AM. Eventually, Ben got in contact with Sega, and I'll let him talk from here on out.
I dig and so dig to see if there was a way to generate some enthusiasm for a feature film to be the third season of Sat AM. I was given the name of a Sega executive and had a most pleasant conversation. She had to go to a meeting, but she said she would like to talk to me more about the idea. The next day, I got a call from Ken Penders, who had been alerted by his contact in their office that I was interested in getting a Sonic movie going. I generously offered to include him in the effort and told him my strategy. Get Sega to become interested in the idea by hiring us to interview the creative game designers, executives, etc., and see if we could develop a storyline that would fulfill the third season, and simultaneously give them creative ideas to develop new games. A win-win situation. Then I called Sega back, and I was shocked when the executive lit into me, telling me, "People pay us to develop Sonic product. We don't pay them." Then she hung up on me. Obviously, Penders had related my strategy to them in a less than flattering way. Thanks for the knife, Ken. So, I gave up. Later, I was informed by friendly fans that Penders had written in his message board or some such place that Ben Hurst doesn't know how movies are made in Hollywood. Hey, Ken, read Adventures in Screenwriting by William Goldman and get some humility. Then he dropped hint that he would be the writer for the big Sonic feature film. That was 3 years ago. So, if you're reading between the lines, you can see I don't hold out much hope for seeing a third season of Sat AM, or being the one who does if it happens. And that makes me sad, because if it were to happen, those 13 episodes would sizzle. But this I've learned, never leave a series on a cliffhanger unless you have a contract for the next year, and be more careful in my choice of people to confide in. The short of it is that Penders told Sega that Ben was trying to take over Sonic as a brand. It didn't matter how untrue or how blatantly slanderous that was, Sega no longer had trust in Ben Hurst, who, in 2010, sadly would pass away, and any hope of a season 3 died with him. Unsurprisingly, Ken Penders does not agree with Ben Hurst's version of events. That sequence of events didn't happen either. Nobody ever questions the logic of Ben's claims. He had the Hollywood connection. I didn't! Why would I contact Sega to screw him over when he was my only Hollywood connection at the time? Larry didn't enter the picture for 2 years. Yet another urban myth. To this day, I'll never understand why Ben always thought Sega would pay him to do a Sonic film. It doesn't work that way. We were lining up funding to license from Sega the right to do the film. In retrospect, it was a lost cause because of SOJ. And that's just it. Sega wasn't looking to make the movie. They were looking for someone else to make the movie. They simply wanted to be paid for the right to do the movie. That's what business is all about. Using other people's money. Ben clearly had no business sense. What's ironic about Penders claiming that Ben Hurst took the wrong steps for making a Sonic movie is that Penders did the exact same thing. We now know the real reason that Penders got in the way of Hurst's Sonic movie is because Penders had his own vision for how Sonic should be adapted to the big screen. Let me introduce you to Penders' vision for a Sonic the Hedgehog movie. Behold, Sonic Armageddon. If you've heard of this before, I guarantee it's from Pat Mac's video on various cancelled Sonic films. But even earlier than that, Pat Mac made a tweet about his findings on the films. While everyone's freaking out over the new Sonic movie, I'd like to remind you all of a previous failed Sonic movie pitch. Here's the concept art for Sonic Armageddon, drawn by Ken Penders. It was pitched to DreamWorks in 2002, but to our knowledge, it never got any further than that. Penders was not very happy with Pat's tweet, saying in response to it, "Amazing what bullshit gets spread over the internet. This was never pitched to DreamWorks. It didn't even exist in 2002. It was first pitched to Sega, and only Sega, in September 2003. I have documents to prove it. The only reason it died in 2007 was massive corporate upheaval." Ken does have a fair point in that Pat Mac's tweets were rather inaccurate, getting notable details wrong. Pat went on to correct these in his video, which can hardly be considered harsh criticism.
"Oh hey, Sonic 1 plays on his TV. That's a nice touch. The real question though is, who's this? Who is this big-lipped man over here?"
But also of note is Ken saying that the film was in development for 4 years and ended in 2007. This is almost certainly untrue. The same year Ken pitched the movie, Sonic Armageddon was also the same year Sonic X came out. Sega had been working to solidify Sonic as a brand and into a cohesive vision for years after the first Sonic Adventure, and Sonic X was the culmination of all of that. Sonic X even began affecting the Archie comics, who went as far as to do a spin-off comic for the Sonic X series. Sonic X was absurdly popular in its day, so the idea that Sega would consider releasing a movie so wildly different is quite frankly ludicrous. This is addressed in Pat Meg's video, where he's likely right in saying the same thing. Another thing we must address about Ken's tweets is what exactly he means when he says the film was cancelled due to massive corporate upheaval. In 2007, Robert Liefler, the licensing director at Sega, passed away at the age of 50 after a brave fight with cancer. Robert and Ken were good friends. Being the licensing manager, he was the man that Penders would approach for approval on stories. When Penders sought to have Sonic Armageddon made into a movie, Robert was the one that Penders went to. When Penders refers to corporate shakeups in reference to Armageddon, he is referring to Robert's passing. While tragic, Robert's death was not a massive corporate shakeup. This is likely Penders projecting his feelings about the loss of his friend onto something else. Any rudimentary Google search will show that no such shakeups occurred around the time of Robert's passing. By itself, Armageddon is nothing more than four pieces of concept art that fail to paint a complete portrait of what the film is. There is one of Sonic's homeworld, Mobius, exploding, and then two random events and a group shot. Penders also created a home video pitch that showed Penders' children.
Said it was just a video game, but I knew better. After all, my dad's job was to search for life on other planets. Although many versions of the events he witnessed made their way out into the media, that was just security doing its job. Like, who could keep a secret that big, right? Anyway, this is what my dad said really happened.
Weirdly enough, this is actually the second time Penders' children have starred in one of his Sonic creations, the first being the comic book Sonic Live. Other than these loosely related concepts, the plot of Sonic Armageddon is lost. Penders has never elaborated on any details, and for all we know, it could have only made it as far as these five pieces. There's nothing more than Penders saying the movie was in development for 4 years to show that the movie was in development for 4 years. If by any chance Penders sees this video and makes it this far in, I would like to invite him to elaborate on Sonic Armageddon. If we're to take his word from it, it's been 13 years since all development stopped on this film, but more likely 17 years since this film died. And after the success of this year's film, this movie is never going to come out. So, I want to know more about Sonic Armageddon. The way I see it, There's no reason to hold on to everything about this film, as it never stands a chance of being made, and I would honestly love to know more about it. Penders' career in the larger entertainment industry was not very long and not very notable, but very soon, he would be thrust into the public light like never before. On September 30th, 2008, Sega published a collaboration with the developer BioWare, well known for their Mass Effect and Dragon Age franchises, in the form of Sonic Chronicles: The Dark Brotherhood. The game was released on the Nintendo DS and is an RPG set in the Sonic the Hedgehog universe. The overall storyline is not that important, except for the main villains. The main villains are a secret society of echidnas with technology years ahead of our own with fascist undertones. Sound familiar? Because what I just described is the Nocturnus clan from Sonic Chronicles. But it could also easily be Ken Penders' own secret hidden society of echidnas with technology years ahead of our own with fascist undertones, the Dark Legion. Placed side by side, their names look like someone took out a dictionary and found some synonyms. Ken claims that a person from BioWare had attempted to approach him at a con about the game, but never followed up after missing his chance to talk. It was later while discussing the situation with his wife that he decided to talk to his lawyer. Ken then made a move that most would consider insane. Ken went through every single issue he had ever written and copyrighted well over 200 characters. The originality of characters didn't matter to Penders. No matter how derivative they were, no matter how small they were, they belonged to Ken. He wasn't just copywriting characters, but entire concepts. Flash forward to 2010, after 1 year of copywriting his characters, Penders had his copyrights approved, and Sega and Archie were both notified in case they wanted to challenge him. But for some reason, Archie Comics decided to wait 7 whole months before they decided to sue Penders for the breach of his contracts. It would not have been hard for Archie to have stopped Penders. All they had to do was show Penders' work for hire form, which he had definitely signed, as shown in this forum post from 1999. If they had done that, the case would have died immediately. All should have gone well for Archie. By all accounts, the cards were stacked in their favor. They even had a copy of that elusive work for hire form. A photocopy. Which is where it all falls apart. In a comprehensive Tumblr post by the amazing Sally Hogan, which Penders himself considers a reliable source, they say, after some initial back and forth, Archie Comics filed a federal lawsuit against Penders on November 23rd, 2010, alleging that he had broken their contract with them. However, Archie's claim had a big hole. They were unable to produce a contract from the start of his work for them. They had, what they alleged, were photocopies of the two documents from December 1996, but there were several problems. 1. As photocopies, their legal validity was in dispute. 2. Penders maintained that the documents were faked, stating that a company that had been doing graphic reproduction for decades had sufficient somehow to produce forgeries. 3. Penders had started at Archie in 1993, not 1996, and thus even if the contracts were judged valid, they might not cover his first years of work, including when he created the Dark Legion characters that were alleged inspiration for Sonic Chronicles. This may be disputable, however. According to the contracts, a creator gives Archie the rights to any past, pending, or future contributions to comics published by Archie. Archie had previously been successful in arguing that contracts covered content produced for Archie that were made before the contract was signed. 4. The paperwork seemed incomplete at points, with several boxes never filled and no mention of Sega, Sonic, the Hedgehog, Knuckles, etc. A screw-up of this magnitude was not unforeseen by Penders, as he knew exactly what he was getting into. Penders knew that Archie was, to put it bluntly, a disorganized mess. Archie was supposed to tell Sega when they created a character, so Sega could copyright them. In actuality, Archie never really talked to Sega. And in their defense, Sega never talked to them. If you want concrete proof that Sega never really communicated with anyone they partner with, you can take a look back at the beginning with every adaptation in the 90s. Ken, knowing that Sega and Archie never really talked, allowed him to see this blatant hole in management and exploit it. So, Archie was caught with their pants down. Their legal defense was a mess. Due to a mishap with the work-for-hire form, they desperately needed Sega to back them up. And Sega, in their typical uncaring fashion, decided to offer absolutely zero assistance to Archie, which hurt Archie deeply, especially when Archie replaced its entire legal team with an actually competent one, leaving the case even more confused. We can see this from a transcript of the case from BleedingCool.com. You have been in the case 6 months yourself. That's right, we received the prior lawyer's exerting retaining. So if you'll allow me, What's been focused on is the rule in copyright law which governs who owns the copywriting as between a hiring party and, if you have any familiarity with the case, you know that I know all of what you're saying. So, what's been missed, Your Honor, is this. The question is, this is a derivative work. The underlying rights here don't come from Archie. They come from a contract between Sega of America, which owns the copyrights, which then granted to Archie the right to use the copyright for a particular purpose. Archie, in turn, hired Mr. Penders. The cases have said that in this circumstances, the ownership of the derivative work is governed by the said intention of the licensor and the licensee in the grant. And it's that I'd like to be able to write, at least explain that authority. So, what you're saying is the prior counsel blew it. Absolutely, Your Honor. Yes, I get all of that. Do you want to settle? Desperately. Does the client want to settle? Desperately, Your Honor. Do you want to settle?
Yes, Your Honor, and we take issue—
Yes, of course you do, otherwise we'd have a settlement. I don't take issue with the facts as he's reciting them. I take issue with their willingness to engage in a discussion over that possible schedule. Well, I'm just trying to figure out. He says he desperately wants to settle. I can explain to you— No, you've explained plenty. Do you desperately want to settle also? Yes, Your Honor. And in fact, we'd love to adhere to the terms of the settlement from November. We're going to end up having to pay for Sega's defense. It's pretty obvious though, isn't it? Why don't you just bring in Sega to your settlement conversations? I mean, if there's some other missing aspect. Right, we have. Until we can interject into the discussion the rule. What the courts have said about the ownership of the derivative rights, then there's no point. You're talking, forgive me. Please, please. You're talking about angels on a pin. So, practical lawyers. Practical lawyers, they want a lot of money. Can I finish? Of course. So practical lawyers say if there's a missing person, so to speak, who's already been sued and that's indispensable to the resolution of your, meaning the two of you, controversy, so bring in the third person and three lawyers, sit down and settle the case, right? You have a claim against the third party. Separate claim, right? Yes, Your Honor. We would agree with everything you've just said. We've been asked not to contact Sega, and we've adhered to their wishes. That makes no sense. Judge, the case won't go away though, because Sega won't offer a dime. Eventually, after a multitude of delays and 2 years of a messy legal battle, the judge ruled against summary judgment with Archie versus Ken Penders, who decided to come to an agreement. And the battle ends in November 2012. And was finalized in 2013, leaving the Archie Sonic continuity scrambled, which we'll return to later. At the same time Archie sued Penders for a breach of contract, Penders was in another legal fight. At the same time he was being sued by Archie, he decided to sue EA, who owns BioWare, for their infringement on his creation, the Dark Legion. EA, unlike Archie, was more than capable of defending themselves without any of Sega's help. Kenga put up as good a fight as he wanted, and it didn't matter. Within 4 months of Penders suing EA, the case had been dismissed. Even after Penders refiled and had it sent to the 9th Appellate Court, the initial ruling was upheld and Penders was helpless to do anything. EA's best option with Penders was to do nothing. As long as BioWare never touched Dark Chronicles again, Penders was incapable of doing anything to them. Thanks to this, Dark Chronicles infamously ends on a cliffhanger, leaving fan favorite Shade the Echidna to fade away into oblivion. Ken keeps hinting at further legal action, but it's been half a decade since his last comment, and it's unlikely that this case will ever be reopened. While EA had walked away unscarred, the worst damage being on a cliffhanger on a game that wasn't well received in the first place. Archie, however, was not so lucky. The damage done by Penders' legal case caused the company to reinvent the entire Archie Sonic line. After a crossover with Archie's Mega Man series, they rebooted the comic and wiped out all Penders' adjacent characters. 200 Sonic characters disappeared overnight. Some were fan favorites, others were the scrappies. Even characters not owned by Penders were wiped out of continuity, just to make sure no other disgruntled ex-employee would come knocking at the door again. The fallout of the lawsuit uncharacteristically caused Sega to get involved and put their foot down with heavy restrictions on what the comic was allowed to do. Most notably, all new characters belonged to Sega. Other restrictions involve no longer being able to create family members for pre-existing characters, no longer being allowed to use characters not from games or Sat AM, no longer being allowed to create other Metal Sonics, Sonic cannot cry, Sonic cannot lose, Sonic characters cannot be in relationships, Sonic characters cannot die. In short, if Penders was known for doing it, other writers could not do it anymore. The list of restrictions continues to grow to this day, and Sega seems to be applying it to other adaptations as well. Even though the Archie reboot was very well received, and by all accounts, sold well, they were unable to fully recover. In 2017, after 290 issues, Archie lost the license to one of their bestsellers. Sega gave the comics rights to IDW, who continues the Sonic comics to this day. The new comics carry the same spirit as before, in no small part to the fact that almost all of the same creative team works on them, and the comics are using stories that they had meant for Archie anyways. Things did not have to be this hard for Archie, as proven by how EA handled the exact same situation, and also shown by Archie themselves. Shortly after the legal mess with Penders, Archie's Sonic contributor, Scott Fulop, emboldened by Penders' actions, sought to sue Archie for the use of his characters, mainly Mammoth Mogul. He was quickly shot down. Archie, having learned their mistakes, was far more prepared to handle the situation and had the case thrown out in no time. Archie's story is a cautionary tale. A tale of bad management and worse communication. All it would have taken was them not losing a single sheet of paper, and they would still have a bestseller. But they didn't. And thanks to this, Penders was able to exploit an opening and indirectly kill the longest-running comic book adaptation of a pre-existing property. Archie had changed its focus as a company and wanted to move on to other ventures. They rebooted the main Archie line and had shifted to making more mature spin-offs, and decided to dive headfirst into other pursuits such as Riverdale. Sega gave the rights to IDW, and that's where the stories end respectively, but not Penders. He's still working on the Republic show, whenever that might finish. But more notably, he was now in the unique situation of being the only man to own, individually, 200 Sonic the Hedgehog characters. So Penders began working on an unofficial spin-off sequel series to the comic sub-series, Mobius, 25 years later. Thing is, it doesn't matter how many echidnas he owns, he doesn't own, well, the echidna species itself. He also doesn't own the main character 25 years later, Knuckles the Echidna. So, he compromised. He still owned Lara Sue, and that was good enough for him. The Lara Sue Chronicles was announced during his legal battle with Archie in 2011. In a post on his website, he claimed it was coming in 2012. 9 years later, the Lara Sue Chronicles languishes in development. He plans for the Lara Sue Chronicles to be a multimedia project, using Ken's acquired cast of characters. Ken has explicitly compared Lara Sue to Jack Kirby's New God series, one of the most revolutionary comic series of all time. He'll sporadically release updates for it, usually unfinished pages and concept art, showing his characters, such as Jeffrey St. John, Leon Day, Lara Sue's father, who has been creatively named Knox, and, bizarrely, one modeled after actor Anthony Mackie, best known for playing the Falcon in the MCU. Ken has also discussed his unique idea for a release format, having an app solely dedicated to the comic. The app consists of disjointed ideas, including his awkward release format and ideas such as voice acting. Aside from a few pages and small segments of script, there's not much in the way of plot. Ken sees Lara Sue as his legacy, but his true mark is on the Sonic community. It's hard to go a day on any fan forum without seeing his name mentioned. He has spawned a lengthy thread on the Kiwi Farms. There's a subreddit dedicated to him, which name should speak volumes about the type of discussion on it. On Sonic Stadium, there is a thread consisting of 423 pages dedicating to hating Penders. It is still growing to this day. Other than that, he is rather irrelevant. Occasionally, he'll make a J.K. Rowling-esque tweet that garners controversy. Rather be retconning who took Sally's virginity, insulting Ben Hurst, involving himself in Ace discourse, or picking a fight with other Archie contributors like Ian Flynn, who has blocked him for rather obvious reasons. The Lara Sue Chronicles has been in development since December 2011, and has been stuck in development hell for 9 years now. With a confusing release format in an era where webcomics and digital platforms such as Comixology are more popular than ever, and I still don't know what's up with the Republic. The future is uncertain for Ken Penders, but if the Lara Sue Chronicles ever does see the light of day, I will be there to read every issue.